A warning, this podcast talks about confronting topics, including violent and aggressive sex and rape.
Rap 6 seems to be experiencing a bit of a cultural moment.
Rough sex is becoming normalized in pop culture and more common in real life. It's appearing in songs, TV shows, and in sexual encounters between young people. When the man who murdered Grace Mullane used rough sex as a defense in his trial 5 years ago, it became part of the national conversation, although it was a quiet conversation. But research suggests many women participating in it don't want to. They feel pressured to take part. It's happening enough to worry experts, and that's why this Friday there's a national conference about it. I'm Gwen McClure, and today on The Detail, how rough sex and choking are becoming normalized in Aotearoa.
One woman that I interviewed, she was 21 when I interviewed her, and she talked about experiences when she was 17. She said she consented to rough sex and to being choked by her boyfriend at the time because she, you know, it's what everyone was talking about. You know, she just thought it was not so much normal as like cool. You know, it was kind of the thing to do, and she was curious.
This is Nicola Gavey. She's a psychologist and professor at Auckland University. She's talking here about someone she interviewed as part of her research.
She never actually really liked it, but she did consent. She was really clear about that. It left her with bruises on her collarbone. She found it difficult to breathe when he was doing it. So it wasn't kind of like a mild, you know, this idea that someone's doing it for her pleasure. It wasn't. You know, he was doing it for his own interests. And she said, looking back on it, that's how she saw it, that he was doing it as a kind of power play, and that this idea of rough sex was just an excuse for men to be violent against women, whereas if he'd done that to her outside of a sexual interaction, It would have been seen as violence.
On Friday, Victoria University of Wellington and MedSAC, that's the Medical Sexual Assault Clinicians Aotearoa, are holding a conference to discuss how rough sex and strangulation are becoming normalized in society. Nicola will be presenting at that conference, and we'll come back to her later in the podcast. First, though, Samantha Keane, who will also be presenting. She's a senior lecturer at the Institute of Criminology at Victoria University. She focuses on gender-based violence and abuse. I thought we should start by defining these terms, but turns out that's hard to do, and that complicates things.
We don't know much about what constitutes rough sex. It's a sort of nebulous, amorphous term that means things to different people. If two people with differing understandings meet up and might have a sexual encounter, and one person's version of rough sex differs, and there might not be an ability to express that is not what matches what that person thought was going to happen. It could be during a progressive sexual activity that someone might feel pressured to continue on with that behavior. You might not physically be able to say stop or no if, say, for example, your breathing was impeded.
Samantha will be giving the opening talk at the conference called Setting the Scene. So I asked her to do that for me.
Rough sex seems to be experiencing a bit of a cultural moment. So the term has seeped into our everyday vernacular, and it's increasingly portrayed throughout popular culture. It appears to feature in the plot lines of popular novels, it's referenced in contemporary movies, and it's in our most sort of popular Netflix TV shows. We see rough sex talked about in men's and women's lifestyle magazines, and it's also in contemporary song lyrics and music videos. So I'm not sure if you would have heard the song, but Jack Harlow's song, which was number one at the start of the year, I believe, the song Loving on Me, talks about being vanilla baby, I'll choke you, but I'm no killer baby.
I'm vanilla baby. I'll choke you, but I ain't no killer, baby.
There was a song by The Weeknd as well where they talk about themes of control, rough sex, wanting to be forced and choked until they pass out. I've got some real concerns about the way that choking and strangulation in particular are eroticized in popular culture. Alongside the presence of these behaviours in contemporary mainstream pornography. So this is sort of the backdrop. And against that backdrop, We are also hearing about people engaging in rougher sexual behaviours in their everyday sexual lives. And I guess while critics will say that, you know, portraying edgy sexual themes in music lyrics, for example, is appropriate for adult audiences, songs such as Take My Breath have become viral hits among young people. You're way too young to end your life. Girl, I don't wanna be the one who pays the price. In fact, the song Take My Breath by The Weeknd was nominated in the favourite song category at the 2022 Nickelodeon Kids' Choice Awards.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So I'm not trying to be prudish, but I think it's important that we recognise that this backdrop of references to and portrayals of rough sexual behaviours that are eroticised and spoken about in ways that suggest that this is common or normal provides the context in which people are now having sex. So that's not to say that everybody will be engaging in these behaviours, but we can certainly think about the way that when we are constantly exposed to messages such as this, that can increase pressure to think that is the type of way or that is the type of sex that people should be interested in engaging in.
So what are the concerns here? What are the real life implications of this?
Yeah, so I guess if we're talking about choking during sex as a specific behaviour within broader rough sexual repertoires, we obviously know that behaviour can be risky. So it could result in anything from a sore throat through to, of course, in the most extreme situations, that can be fatal to engage in. And whilst we've got this term choking to describe that behaviour, I guess we can ask questions about whether we should be more accurately calling that strangulation.
Okay.
And we know that strangulation is a known risk factor for increasing lethality or increasing risk in intimate relationships.
I mean, to some extent, I feel like I've been hearing about this as a conversation, you know, that's out there, an issue for probably at least 5 years, but maybe longer. Do you think it's getting worse?
So we have been talking about this, but I think for me in particular, I'm certainly seeing increasing saturation of rough sexual themes across a wider array of sources. And certainly in contemporary mainstream heterosexual pornography, I think we are right to be questioning the way that choking and strangulation is present within that product, because the sheer scale of engagement with that content is almost staggering, really. I think it was in 2019 that Pornhub reported 42 billion site visits in 1 year, and they claimed that rough sex is an especially common category among women visitors.
Samantha also says that the murder of British backpacker Grace Mullane in December 2018 put, quote, rough sex on the front pages and into the national public conversation.
The accused told police that he and Ms. Mullane had consensual rough sex, which involved some choking. Earlier in the trial, a forensic pathologist called to give evidence for the Crown confirmed Ms. Mullane's death was caused by pressure to the neck. Ron Mansfield told the jury that while accidental deaths in this sort of consensual sexual context were rare, they were possible.
If this couple engaged in consensual sexual activity, which included pressure being applied to her neck with her knowledge and consent, and that went wrong, and no one intended for it to go wrong, that's not murder.
The jury disagreed with that and found Jesse Kempson guilty of murder, but not before intimate details about Grace's life were splashed across headlines.
What I think we have seen in recent years has been the emergence of rough sex in sexual violence cases. And I think that speaks back to that blurriness or muddiness associated with differing understandings or differing definitions of what might constitute rough sex. Perhaps most famously, of course, it here in Aotearoa appeared in the trial for the man who murdered Grace Mullane. But we have seen it in other sexual violence trials as well.
Some of those trials and victims were acknowledged in a recent Netflix documentary about Grace's murder called The Lie. The doco ended with title cards that said between 1972 and 2022,
At least 60 defendants in the UK alone have used the rough sex defence, 45% of which resulted in a lesser charge, lighter sentence, acquittal, or the case not being pursued. I asked Samantha to explain what that rough sex defence is and whether she's been seeing more of it.
The rough sex defence is not a defence as such, but rather I think it's useful for us to consider it as a set of strategies or narratives that might be employed to suggest that what happened during an alleged sexually violent incident was not rape or not sexual assault. Instead, it was just rough sex. And that line or that sort of set of strategies works because it builds on existing myths about sexual violence generally, particularly as well, I think, myths around women's sexuality. So I think what I'm concerned about is that the introduction of this idea that rough sex is something that some women want, and I'm sure that it is. We need to make sure that that isn't morphing into the dangerous assumption that that is what all women want during sex, or all people enjoy rough sexual behaviours, because I don't think that that's an accurate reflection of what many people may understand rough sex to be, and then how it might play out in their sexual experiences.
Let's go back to Nicola. She's currently researching how physical aggression is becoming normalized in sex, and it was actually conversations she had at that trial for Grace Mullane's murder that piqued her interest.
I was quite taken by two conversations I independently had with other women about the same age as me, kind of middle-aged, older woman, who said that their daughters had told them, well, that's just normal these days, you know, sexual choking. And I thought, really, you know, it's a surprise to me. So I started looking into it and, you know, I started asking my students and, you know, that was a really interesting experience in a graduate class that I'd been with for 3 months, asking them, you know, is that the case? And the reactions were really interesting. Like it was just, nobody kind of spoke out and said, oh yeah, that's just normal. But they, all the women were sort of nodding and it was just kind of like really subtle. Sort of a subtle affirmative response.
Her research so far has included a survey and in-depth interviews with women.
And one of the things that I've been finding from those interviews and from the survey is that there is this kind of idea now that that is kind of a normal part of sex. Various aggressive acts, but including choking, slapping sometimes, definitely things like hair pulling or pinning people down. It's quite complicated because I think what people mean by this term rough sex is very variable, mm-hmm. and it can include things that are probably what might have always been happening and maybe just thought of as kind of more, in inverted commas, passionate or vigorous kind of forms of sexual interaction at one end of the spectrum, but then at other ends of the spectrum, it's actually kind of bordering more on violent, you know, sort of unacceptable forms of violence and exploitation. What's been really clear in the research is a lot of women having a lot of concerns about the way that it becomes a kind of almost a sort of an excuse or a kind of provides a rationalisation for men's aggression towards them. And a number of women, for example, talk about it's as though a man's kind of acting out a sort of pornographic script. One of the things that's really complicated about it as well is that sometimes it's clearly non-consensual, and in those cases, obviously, it's a form of violence, you know, physical violence and or sexual violence. But in some cases, it's kind of ambiguous, or a woman might even say she consented, but she later looks back on it and realises that she did that because she felt she had to, because within her cultural milieu at the time, everyone was talking about rough sex and choking, and the opposite of that was vanilla, in quotation marks, and that was considered bad and sort of prudish and old-fashioned and, you know, just really undesirable. One woman talked about, she might have been 21 when I interviewed her, she said she'd had sexual experience with about 20 different partners, men, and I said, at one point I said, have you had any positive experience? And she just laughed at that and said, no, that she was routinely being treated just as a kind of an object for a men's sexual satisfaction. Another woman I spoke to who was incredibly well-informed about consent and all the intricacies of consent, she was 24 when I interviewed her, she described a relationship with a man that she was really infatuated with. She didn't feel she was quite as, you know, cool as him, but she was very infatuated with him and she was going out with him for some time. He would just routinely strangle her during sex or choke her, to sometimes the point that she couldn't breathe. She talked about sometimes, you know, the next morning her throat being all puffy, and she said she just thought, this is just like, why is he doing this? This is just, you know, she really didn't like it. But she said that, you know, it's just really confusing. She didn't consent to it, but she never told him to not do it because she felt that, that within that kind of normalised framework, that this is kind of a thing people do now, to say that you didn't want to do it was, and it's just too difficult. But I think the thing that's interesting, she said that she'd mentioned to her friends that he was doing this to her, and they said, are you okay with it? And she said, oh yeah, I'm kind of okay with it. And she said she wasn't actually okay with it, but she would have been too ashamed to say that she wasn't.
Because it was the cool thing to do.
Because... not, more because if she wasn't okay with it, why was she still in that relationship? Okay. Why was she not? Why was she kind of allowing it to happen?
As a psychologist, does this concern you? What's the worry here?
Yeah, it does concern me because I think, you know, something for somebody to be choked during sex or slapped during sex or even spat on in the past, that would have been seen as a form of, it would have either been seen as a form of abuse and violence, or it would have been seen as a form of a more intentional kind of opting into a BDSM or kink kind of context, which has a whole lot of kind of, you know, ethical safety parameters around it, and an idea that this is not for everyone, this is for people who, you know, have particular interests. The thing that concerns me is that when something is you know, again, this is one of those complicated things, you know, normalisation, there's a lot of positive things sometimes, the normalisation around destigmatising behaviours and identities, for example. But that can be done really uncritically and can be done in a sort of quite idealistic way that almost just disregards the on-the-ground reality that there are still really traditional gendered scripts happening. And so it's all very well to destigmatise, you know, so-called rough sex, if your own experience is always, you know, with a partner that's trusted and respectful and caring. Of course that is happening, but there's just a lot, from what it would suggest from our survey results and then talking to women in depth in interviews, a lot of experiences that young women are having where they're sort of being, you know, just stuff done to them that they'd no interest in. And it concerns me because I think it's really regressive in terms of gender relations and what I think of as kind of intimate justice. I think in terms of what it says, what it's kind of helping to reinforce about the way that, you know, gender dynamics are moving. And also, you know, in terms of the particular act of choking, there is some research that's looked at neuroanatomical shifts in women who have had experiences of sexual choking. So that's not even, you know, choking within a context of violent abuse where, you know, might be very hard and a woman might be unconscious. This is in a sexual context.
So what does that mean? What
changes mean? To the brain.
Oxygen deprivation that...
Yes, it'll be a result of something like that. So that's in the anatomy of the brain. There's early research suggesting that after maybe 20 experiences of this, they can already start to see some differences in the structures of the brain. No one knows really what that means, but the articles, there's, you know, a couple of articles that have looked at that, and they're sort of suggesting that, you know, people who know about brain injury suggests that could be quite concerning in terms of the long-term impacts of that, yeah.
That research is new, but there's plenty of established information about the risks of strangulation. It can cause fainting, seizures, nausea and vomiting, incontinence, miscarriage. And there's another strong risk. One statistic says the risk of being murdered by a partner who's previously choked you is 10 times higher. In a sad irony, the day after Grace was murdered, an unrelated law came into effect that made strangulation illegal. Part of the reason for the law is that, quote, attempts to stop a person from breathing by strangulation or suffocation is a significant risk factor for future violence and lethality. But there is an exclusion when it comes to consent.
I know people who are involved in the construction of that law since, you know, think it was a mistake to have that in there.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I know it's someone anyway who was involved.
Okay.
In that. Yeah.
That's interesting.
I mean, I suppose we would see that in the, you know, in the murder of Grace Mullane. You know, really, how could that ever be? It's just not plausible that someone would consent to be strangled to that degree that they are going to die. The onus should be on people, you know, to be able to prove that they were consenting. So, you know, people who are genuinely doing it as part of a consensual BDSM experience, for example, they need to trust that that other person that they're choking is not going to say it was not consensual and that they're doing it to the level that is agreed to.
Despite the fact that Nicola has been in this field for decades, this research has been particularly difficult for her.
I started doing these interviews 3 years ago and I've had a 3-year pause because it's just really quite hard to see the kind of social justifications that are enabling this kind of, you know, mistreatment of people.
Can you talk at all about how it aligns with your background in
sexual violence?
Sexual violence.
Yeah, I mean, when I was doing these interviews, which was 3 years ago, I was just it got to a point where I was feeling quite upset about it because while I've interviewed a lot of people about experiences of rape and sexual violence, and you know, really horrible, difficult experiences. I don't know, it just seemed really different because in most of those cases, it was always in the context of someone was talking about an experience that they identified as violence or abuse. And so there was no ambiguity in that this was an act that they had suffered at the hands of someone else that socially most people know is wrong. And so in that context, you know, often it could be quite inspiring to see the strength of people coming through those experiences with a shared understanding this is something that's wrong. But what was kind of really so disturbing in some of these interviews was women being subject to just terrible forms of mistreatment, but in a context where there's no discursive kind of support for seeing that as wrong, where they were being subject to aggressive, violent kind of exploitative, extractive kind of acts, but the kind of discursive field is really telling us, well, this is just sex. This was, you know, something you should be up for, you should enjoy. It just felt like this massive, just going back into the dark ages, you know, it's like, what happened? What twisted thing has happened to the so-called sexual revolution and to our kind of our recognition of sexual violence, domestic violence, and our kind of activism and our legal response to it, our social response to it, Me Too movement, you know, all of these major sort of progressive social moves. It felt like just, it's like, oh my God, you know, just, you know, pulling the carpet out of it.
That's all for today. The Detail is a Newsroom production supported by RNZ and New Zealand On Air. This episode was engineered by William Saunders and produced by Alexia Russell and Davina Zimmer. Thank you to Samantha Keane and Nicola Gavey. I'm Gwen McClure, Kaki Te Anō.